I am keen to get started on time so that we can finish on time, because I know you're all busy people and you would probably like to get away right on the dot if possible. We're going to begin with a moment of prayer, but before we do that, I'll just invite Vicky Burrows, who is the Director of Aboriginal Catholic Ministry, to do an acknowledgement of our Aboriginal inhabitants. Thanks. Vicky.
As we begin this moment, we take a moment to centre ourselves and bring us here as we are sitting along the Derbyurigan, the Swan River, and we acknowledge the Whadjuk people of the Noongar Nation as the original custodians and stewardships of this land. We acknowledge that the Noongar people and Aboriginal people across our nation have been in relationship with the land and with the spirit, and that God has been working through our community for many years. And we stand here honouring elders past, present and future, and we look towards, as we walk together with hope and reconciliation in the work we do, and how we're here as our church, as pilgrims here on earth.
Thank you, Vicky, very much. And as I say, we wanted to begin just with a moment of prayer. I want to talk about quite an important issue for our Archdiocese this morning, and I think we need to situate that within the context of our faith. So I'll just give you a moment to read that short quote from the Rule of Saint Benedict as a way into our understanding of what it is that we're about to do together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We have committed ourselves as an archdiocese to be a people walking together in the footsteps of the Good Shepherd. So let us pause for a moment to reflect on who it is that we are following.
I spread out my tail.
Pray together the prayer for our Archdiocese of Perth. Gracious God, you have blessed our diocese with many gifts, and you call us to share those gifts with others. We thank you for this call and commit ourselves anew to responding with courage and generosity. In this time of challenge and hope for the Church, you invite us to start afresh from Christ your Son and to contemplate his face, so that we might recognise him in others, especially those who suffer. In doing so, may we experience a new wave of grace, so that the light of Christ may burn more brightly in our lives. Attune our hearts and minds to the presence of your Holy Spirit, that our Church may be transformed, our relationships be healed, and our nation grow in compassion and justice. With the intercession of St. Mary MacKillop, who showed us new ways of living the gospel, we make our prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Mary, help of Christians.
Pray.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Well, once again, welcome everybody, and thank you for making the time to come this morning for what I think is a very important moment for us in the Archdiocese. It's a first step in opening up something that I think has great importance for our Archdiocese, but also, of course, for the whole Church in Australia. I just want to explain briefly what I hope to do with you during this time. So we've got a program. Whether we'll get through it all is anybody's guess. Probably the answer is no, but we'll see how far we get. I wanted to begin, as we have done, with an opening prayer, and then talk about the Plenary Council. The purpose of this morning's gathering is, first of all, to share with the leadership of our Archdiocese and all of the agencies, or most of them, many of them anyway, exactly what this is all about, because some of you will have heard about the fact that the bishops have called a Plenary Council for 2020. If you followed the work of the Royal Commission, particularly in its final hearings, you would see how focused the Royal Commission was on the Plenary Council as a way for the Church to deal with some of the issues that we're facing. But many of you may not know what a Plenary Council is at all, exactly what it's all about, why we made the decision that we've made to move in this direction. And so, because you're the leadership of the diocese, and any of these initiatives will only be successful to the extent that we get buy-in from everybody in the diocese, I wanted to open it up this morning as an initial discussion, if you like, opening up the conversation. But hopefully this will be just the beginning of a gradual assimilation of exactly what it is the bishops are trying to achieve by calling together this Plenary Council. So I want to talk first of all about the journey to the Plenary Council. What is it? And have a bit of a look at canon law, a little bit of a look at church tradition and some past experience, not in any great detail. You're all capable of opening up a book of canon law and reading it for yourselves, but I just wanted to open up and give you a sense of what this is and also perhaps what it isn't. I think one of the challenges for us in understanding the Plenary Council and the decision of the bishops is to do exactly that, understand what it is and what it might be able to achieve, but also recognise that it's not the answer, the only answer, to all of the challenges the Church is facing. I then want to talk about the origins of this proposal. It came to birth in the Bishops' Conference, and it's very much connected to the Year of Grace. And many of you would have sat in this room at different times a few years ago, being involved in the whole journey of the Year of Grace. and then we're going to have morning tea. So my plan is to break about in about half an hour or so for morning tea. That's a time, I think, to have a cup of tea or coffee, but also to chat with each other about what I've said so far. And then after morning tea, I want to talk about the journey ahead. And I've put up on the screen there, establishing an enabling structure. I need lots of advice and input from people as to how we go about actually making this thing work in our archdiocese here in Perth. And one of the particular challenges, which is also an opportunity that I see, is the fact that whilst the bishops of Australia have called this plenary council, we already are deeply engaged in the implementation of our archdiocesan plan. I don't want the plan to get lost while we sort of put that on one side and worry about the plenary council, but nor do I want the plenary council to get lost because we say, well, we don't need that, we've got our plan. So part of the challenge is, how are we going to bring these things together? And then on top of these two very important things in the life of the diocese, the Australian bishops also have called a year for youth from December this year until December next year. It's 10 years since the World Youth Day in Sydney, and to mark that occasion, we're having a year of youth. It's going to kick off with a big Australian Catholic Youth Festival in Sydney in November, December, and we're hoping that a lot of our young people will go to that. But that's the beginning of a whole year of youth, and the Australian bishops are asking us as a church to really think quite hard and quite specifically about how we tap into the richness of the young people of our church and how they can help us to be the church we're supposed to be and how we can help them to be fully integrated into the church as well. So that's a big challenge for us, and I'll say a word about that in a moment. But Pope Francis has also decided that the next synod of bishops will be dedicated to young people. The theme will be young people, faith and vocational discernment. So we've got four big themes. One is international, one is the upcoming synod of bishops, and from memory I think it's Bishop Edwards from Melbourne and Archbishop Fisher from Sydney who will be the bishops attending the synod on behalf of the Australian Catholic bishops. This is an international event and holds out a lot of hope for the church. So we need to be engaged in that as well. The Year of Youth for us in Australia is a very important initiative. It's a chance to perhaps recapture some of the energy that World Youth Day generated in Australia 10 years ago, which has really been the mainstay of our outreach to young people in the Australian church ever since. And then we have the preparations for the Plenary Council, and we have the ongoing work with our diocesan plan. If I get time, I want to also just say a few words about the Plenary Council and the Royal Commission, because as I said, at the time of the final hearings of the Royal Commission, the fact that the bishops had independently decided to call a Plenary Council was seen as a positive sign by the Royal Commission. And they are, I think, investing a lot of hope and certainly great expectations in the Plenary Council. Then we'll break again for a bit of discussion if we have time, question and answers, and a final prayer. That's a lot to fit in between now and 11:30. We'll do our best. Most of this is going to be me talking to you about these things because I think this is the opening gambit. This is the initial opening up of this issue, and I think we all need to be well informed about what we're actually talking about. So first of all, what does canon law say about a plenary council? In a moment I'll explain why the bishops decided on a plenary council rather than something else. We could have decided on a synod for the Australian church, we could have decided on local synod at each diocesan level, we could have made all sorts of decisions. We decided on a plenary council, and I'll explain that in a little while. But let me first explain what it is. In essence, it's just a meeting of bishops. And that will happen in 2020. But in many ways, that's not, in any sense, the most important part. It's the engagement of the whole church in the preparations for the Plenary Council, which will determine whether or not the Plenary Council has any impact at all on our church in Australia. So, what is it? We've got a couple of people here I know who are interested in canon law, so you might find this interesting. For the rest of you, I'll try and move through it fairly quickly. But there it is. Canon law explains for us what it is, and it will give us the parameters, if you like, in which we're going to be operating. Plenary Council, that is one for all the particular churches of the same conference of bishops. A particular church is a church with a bishop at its head. So a diocese, in other words. So the particular churches in Australia, the Archdiocese of Perth and the Archdiocese of Brisbane and the Diocese of Broome and the Diocese of Townsville, etc. That's what particular churches means. So a Plenary Council is one for all the particular churches of the Bishops' Conference. And our Bishops' Conference incorporates Australia. It incorporates all the Western churches, so that's all the dioceses with which we're familiar. It incorporates the Ordinariate of Our Lady of the Southern Cross. It incorporates the Military Ordinariate, and it incorporates the Eastern Catholic Churches as well. So it's a gathering of all of the particular churches here in Australia. It is to be celebrated whenever it seems necessary or useful to the Conference of Bishops. Only a Conference of Bishops can make a decision to convene a council, and it can only go ahead once it's been approved by the Apostolic See, by the Pope. I'm not sure what's going on. Pope Francis must be having a bit of a rest at the moment because we still haven't got the formal approval. He probably has other things to think about on top of whether or not he's going to say yes to our Plenary Council. But according to Archbishop Coleridge, who is the chair of the Bishop's Commission preparing for the Plenary Council, we've been assured in Rome that the approval will be given. So we're going ahead on that basis. If the Pope decides to cancel it, just forget all about this morning. Just while I'm talking about that, I should mention too that the Australian Catholic Bishops' Conference has established a Bishops' Commission for the preparation and implementation of the Council. Archbishop Coleridge was elected as the chair of that commission. I'm trying to remember if I can count all the members. I'm a member of the commission. Bishop Vincent Long, Bishop of Parramatta, is a member. Bishop Tarabay, pardon me, who is the Maronite Bishop, I think Bishop Michael Kennedy from Lismore or Armidale. So there's a number of bishops on it, and we're responsible for overseeing the implementation of the council. So it falls to the Conference of Bishops, so that's Australian Catholic Bishops' Conference, all the Catholic bishops in Australia, to first of all convoke the council, to select the place to celebrate the council within the territory of the Conference of Bishops. Archbishop Coleridge is talking at the moment about maybe two sessions actually of the council meeting itself. And one might be, I don't know, in Sydney, one might be at Ayers Rock or something. He's talking about all sorts of possibilities. We'll just have to wait and see. But as I say, those meetings, vital though they are, and I'll explain why in a minute, are really the end point of a process that starts now. To select from among the diocesan bishops a president of the Plenary Council, whom the Apostolic See must approve. So the bishops have to choose a president and submit that name to the Pope. And it's up to the Bishops' Conference to determine the agenda and questions to be treated, to set the opening and duration of a Plenary Council, to transfer, extend, and dissolve it. So this is very much something that is an initiative of the bishops. And it's an initiative of the bishops because the bishops in Catholic theology are understood to be those appointed or chosen by God and appointed with the authority of the Pope to lead the particular churches. So the bishops will have the responsibility, as it says there, of determining the agenda and the questions to be treated. But they're not just going to sit down in a little huddle amongst themselves and come up with this. This is the whole point of a very extensive consultation that will be conducted right across the church in Australia in order to assist the bishops to determine the agenda and the questions that the council has to deal with. The following must be called to particular councils, that includes plenary councils, and has the right of a deliberative vote. So there'll be all sorts of proposals which will emerge from the consultations and from the work of the commissions and all the rest of it. They will ultimately come to the bishops and those who have a right to vote in the plenary council. And the plenary council has the authority to enact legislation for the church in Australia. So to give you an example of the kinds of things that a plenary council might do, not the one that we're looking to now, but ones that have happened in the past. A plenary council, for example, might make a decision to establish a Catholic education system in the country. They can be as significant and as far-reaching as that. So it's a very important moment for the church because as we hopefully hear all the voices of the church and begin to understand exactly what the challenges ahead of us are, and proposals come forward as to how we might meet those challenges, the bishops will then be able to determine how we might put structures in place to help us achieve those things. So who has a vote? Diocesan bishops, so that's bishops and archbishops who are in charge of a diocese. Coadjutor and auxiliary bishops, so Bishop Sproxton as an auxiliary bishop. Other titular bishops who perform in the territory a special function committed to them by the Apostolic See or the Conference of Bishops. I don't think we have too many of those in Australia, but it might be a person who's a bishop but has a particular role that isn't about governing the diocese. They're quite common in other parts of the world. I'm not sure that we have any in Australia. I can't think of any, no. So that doesn't actually apply to us. And even retired bishops living in the territory can be called to particular councils, and they also have the right of a deliberative vote. It says other titular bishops, so I presume, I don't know whether that excludes Archbishop Hickey or not, I'll have to have a chat to him and see where he stands in all of that. Then there's a whole lot of other people who can come, or who rather must be called to particular councils, but with only a consultative vote. We're talking here about the actual meeting of the bishops, right at the end of the process. Who gets to be there in the final sessions when these big decisions are made? So the Vicars General, so Father Peter Whiteley, Episcopal Vicars of all the particular churches in the territory. So people have those sort of very significant areas of responsibility. They're also part of it. They have a consultative vote. Major superiors of religious institutes and societies of apostolic life. In a number for both men and women, which the Conference of Bishops or the Bishops of the Province are to determine. So that's a decision for the bishops to decide who amongst the religious leaders, religious brothers and sisters, and religious priests will be present with a consultative vote. Rectors of ecclesiastical and Catholic universities and deans of faculties of theology and of canon law, which have a seat in the territory. So Celia and I will have to have a discussion about what that might look like for Notre Dame. And rectors of major seminaries elected by the rectors of the seminaries which are located in the territory in a number to be determined by the bishop. So we have two seminaries. We have Father Michael Moore at Morley and Father Philip Flay at Guildford, presuming they're both still in place in 2020. And they may or may not be part of this gathering. Okay, I told you if you weren't interested in canon law, you'd find this probably a bit tedious, but I think it's just important because it'll give you a sense of exactly what this kind of gathering is all about. Presbyters, that's priests, and other members of the Christian faithful can also be called to particular councils only with a consultative vote and in such a way that their number does not exceed half the number of those mentioned just before. So those with a mathematical brain can work that out. But it will involve a representative group of priests and members of the faithful who can be called. Cathedral chapters, presbyteral council, that's the council of priests that advises me here in Perth, the pastoral council of each particular church. We don't have a diocesan pastoral council at this stage. Whether we will by 2020 or not is something that we will still need to consider. Are to be invited, so they send two of their members, etc., and others can be invited as guests. Okay, that's all the kind of practical things, but what's it all for? The particular council, our plenary council, for its own territory, takes care that provision is made for the pastoral needs of the people of God and possesses the power of governance, especially legislative power. Now, you don't want to just pass over that phrase. Takes care that provision is made for the pastoral needs of the people of God. That's the point of a plenary council. To make sure that as a church, we're actually meeting the needs of the people of our Catholic community. That's what it's for. And the needs of our Catholic community are very diverse. It includes those who go to Mass every Sunday, those who go to Mass occasionally, those who never go to Mass, those who are intimately connected with the church, those who are just hanging on by the skin of their teeth. It's the people of God in a particular territory, which for us, in our context here, is the Archdiocese of Perth. How do we meet the pastoral needs of our people? And you can only answer that once you've really understood what the pastoral needs of our people are. And for that to happen, our people need to tell us. We need to find ways of listening to people so that we can discern exactly what it is that the Holy Spirit is asking of us in the church. Then it goes on to say, always without prejudice to the universal law of the church, it is able to decide what seems opportune for the increase of the faith, the organisation of common pastoral action, the regulation of morals, and the common ecclesiastical discipline which is to be observed, promoted, and protected. Increase of faith. Organisation of common pastoral action. Regulation of morals and ecclesiastical discipline, and all without prejudice to the universal law of the church. So if I could give you just very briefly a quick example of this kind of thing and what that might mean. The Royal Commission might decide that it's going to recommend to the government that the seal of the confessional be abolished as a privileged part of the sacrament of confession. And the Royal Commission has every right to make whatever recommendations it wants to make. The Catholic bishops of Australia, even if they wanted to, and they don't, but even if they wanted to, have absolutely no authority whatsoever to touch the question of the discipline of the sacraments in the Universal Catholic Church. So that's what this is kind of trying to get at when it says without prejudice to the universal law of the church. A local church, if it wants to be part of the worldwide communion of the Catholic Church, can't say, well, you know, the rest of the church has this crazy rule, we don't like it, so we're going to change it and do our own thing. We wouldn't any longer be a part of the worldwide Catholic Church. So there are some things that can change, some things that can't. One of the challenges for this kind of church at the universal level, but even at the local level, is to help us understand the nature of the church better so that we have a sense, an instinct, about what is essential for us as the Catholic community and what may be changed and may well need to be changed. That's a big task. And I think most of us would need to be aware, and I'm including myself here, that we may not be the final arbiter of what can and can't be changed, what is actually essential and what isn't. We're part of a wider reality called the Catholic Church. So there's going to be a need for both courage and humility at the same time as we deal with this, because all sorts of proposals will come forward. We're not going to censor anything or say, oh, we're not allowed to ask that question. But it could well be that some proposals will come forward that in fact can't be acted on because they're not in harmony with our understanding of what being the church is all about. That's a big challenge for us. I think myself, it's probably going to be the most difficult thing for us to deal with as we deal with the Plenary Council. When a particular council has ended, the president is to take care that all the acts of the council are sent to the Apostolic See. Decrees issued by a council are not to be promulgated until the Apostolic See has reviewed them. So if we were to decide something about Catholic education, which, you know, was going to be a major, major change to the way we understand the role of Catholic education in Australia, it would need to go to Rome and for Rome to consider whether or not this change would be in harmony with our understanding of what the Church is all about. So ultimately, final decisions have to be ratified by Rome. And then it's for the Council itself to define the manner of the promulgation of the decrees and the time when the promulgated decrees begin to oblige. I'm not sure if they did it at a plenary council, I can't quite remember, but the bishops of England in Wales a few years ago decided to reintroduce the practice of abstinence from meat on Fridays. I'm not suggesting that we would do that in Australia, but that's a change in our law. If we wanted to change that law, it would have to get approval from Rome. So some things are obviously much more significant than others. You know, making major change to Catholic education is one thing, deciding whether you need meat on Fridays or not is another thing altogether. But major decisions will have to be referred to Rome. So as I highlighted already, I think this is the key to what a plenary council is all about. Making provision for the pastoral needs of the people of God. And for each one of you, in terms of your agency or your organisation, you have immediate and direct contact with often a very large group, sometimes a smaller group, but of concrete flesh and blood people who have real pastoral needs. And the council is all about trying to find ways to meet those needs. I think it's, when you think about it like that, I think you can see the potential in the Plenary Council. It offers us a great deal of hope if we're successful in holding it all together in the process. If we do this well, it could be a moment of real renewal and growth and deepening of communion for the Church in our Archdiocese. If we do it badly, it might be a source of dissension and disunity. I think we need to be upfront about both of those possibilities and know which one we want to commit ourselves to. We want to commit ourselves to this being an instrument of renewal and communion, not an instrument of disunity and dissolution. So the key points. Because the Plenary Council has legislative and governance powers, final decisions are reserved to those who hold the power of governance in the Church by nature of their episcopal ordination. That's the bishops. And in our Catholic understanding, it's the bishops as together that group of people who succeed to the role of the apostles in the life of the Church. It's a kind of an intimidating thing for a bishop to stand up and say he belongs to a group of people who succeed the apostles in their role in the Church. But that's what we as Catholics believe about the bishops in the Church. That's why the final decisions are reserved to them. But any bishop with half a brain won't make decisions until he's listened to a lot of people, so that he's not just going off his own prejudices and his own whims. But ultimately, the bishops will have to take responsibility. The decisions are subject to confirmation by the Pope as the successor of Peter and the head of the College of Bishops, the Apostolic College. In Catholic theology, the College of Bishops only hold together as a unified group because each of them are in communion with the head of the college, who is the Pope. It's kind of Catholic theology 101, really, but it's important for us to remember. This is important. The bishops are obliged to make decisions on the basis of their careful discernment of the work of the Holy Spirit in the minds and hearts of all the people of God. The Christe Fidelis is the Latin phrase, Christ's faithful. Now remember, Christ's faithful is all of us together. There's not the bishops and then Christ's faithful, or the bishops and priests and then Christ's faithful. There's just Christ's faithful. We're all in it together. It's the role of the bishops to discern the work of the Spirit in the people of God. And we need lots of help to do that. And this process of discernment, and this is the key really to what I hope will be germinated this morning, this process of discernment which requires careful and extensive consultation with the people of God is as important as the final process of decision making. So it brings me back again to you as key leaders in the Archdiocese of Perth, because it will be you that I'll be looking to energise and animate and engage the people whom you lead to be a part of this process of discernment and consultation. The more voices we hear and the more careful reflection on all of those different voices that we're able to undertake, the more likely we are to discern where the Spirit of God is leading us. And having said that, it's probably important for me to say at the start that we don't know where the Spirit of God is going to lead us. If we knew that already, we wouldn't need the plenary council. We wouldn't need the consultation. Archbishop Coleridge, who has a very fine turn of phrase and can be quite poetic, he keeps talking about the plenary council as an Abrahamic journey. That's something to write down and use if you need something. Abraham was called by God to leave his father and leave his land and go to another land to which the Lord would lead him. And Abraham set out not having the foggiest where he was going to end up. In a sense, that's what Archbishop Coleridge is suggesting to us the plenary council is about. We're setting out on a journey. We're setting out together. We don't quite know where we're going to end up. We have to have confidence in each other and in the Holy Spirit, and we have to keep our eyes fixed on the one we're following. That's the kind of journey that we're undertaking. Okay, so that's canon law. That tells you what it is, but I think it might be useful to think about what theological insights we can bring to that more prosaic and practical kind of information. Yesterday I spent a morning with our catechist coordinators and with many of our priests. We were talking about Christian leadership in the church today. And I was saying to them that if you're going to be a Christian leader in the church, you have to understand what the church is. How can you lead if you don't know anything much about or don't understand in depth the organisation of which you're a part? So one of the big challenges for us is to understand what this thing is that we call the church and of which we are a part and to which we are committed. And I think that's going to be a challenge for all of us, and I think it's particularly a challenge for us as leaders to be as confident as we can that we understand the church so that we're truly able to lead people into a deeper engagement with the church. So I would think that one of the things that we're going to have to do a fair bit of thinking about, and people like Marco might be able to help us here in the Centre for Faith Enrichment, how are we going to deepen people's understanding, our understanding, of what the church really is? So, as a slight, tiny beginning, the church is the people of God. This comes straight out of Vatican II. The church is the mystical body of Christ. The church is the sacramental sign. We all know what sacraments are. They're visible, tangible things you can grab hold of, which point to something much deeper. The church is the sacramental sign, the visible and tangible sign. This is the ideal, of course. We're not always terribly good at it. But this is the ideal. The church, that's us, is this visible, tangible, touchable sign of the ongoing and effective presence of Christ in the world. That's who we are. That's what we're all about. And if we're not about that, we should shut up shop and go home. The church is the privileged place for the encounter with God in Christ through the work of the Holy Spirit. And when I say the church, I'm not talking about the cathedral or talking about the bishop, or I'm talking about the local reality of how people engage with the church and experience the church. And if you like, the responsibility that we as leaders in the church have to make sure that this is how people do actually experience the church. When they encounter us in our role as leaders of Catholic agencies, they're supposed to be encountering a visible, touchable, graspable experience of the ongoing presence of Jesus reaching out to them in their lives. That's why renewal of the church is so important, because we're not always very good at this, and we need to get better at it. The second thing to remind ourselves of is that all those who are baptized together have received this common vocation. It's not the preserve of the bishops or the priests or the religious or the professionals. It actually comes with baptism. The little babies will get baptized next weekend in the cathedral, will become part of this reality, which is meant to be this living, effective sign of Christ in the church. So we are together, a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people set apart. Yesterday morning, I spent the whole morning unpacking some of these sorts of things. We don't have time to do that now, but we may need to do it at some stage. If we're going to lead, we need to understand the institution in which we're exercising our leadership. Then within this sacramental people, so the people come first, the community comes first. That's really important. Within that community, we have those who are ordained, deacons, priests and bishops, but particularly priests and bishops, are meant to be this living, touchable, graspable sign that Jesus is with us as the Good Shepherd. That's the role of priests and bishops in particular. And then most importantly, because we're baptized, all of us share the responsibility for helping the church be what it's supposed to be. We can't sort of pass that responsibility on to someone else. We can't sit back and say, oh, we've got a bishop, we've got a few priests around, they can do all of that stuff, and we'll just sit back and, you know, hope for the best. So I think the Plenary Council is going to call us all to grab hold of our responsibilities as members of this community of faith. And so, because of the role of governance, I've talked about that a little while before, because the bishops are this sacramental sign of the presence of Christ in his church as its head, as its shepherd, we have the responsibility, ultimately, of discerning from all of these voices that we're going to hear and that together we're going to hear, what's actually in harmony with our authentic teaching, tradition and fundamental beliefs. Because the real question is, how do we make the church here in our archdiocese a more faithful expression of what the Lord wants his church to be? I said yesterday when I was speaking to the catechists that we often talk about our church, and so we should. I go around to lots of parishes and people talk about our parish, and so they should. But we always need to remember that before it's our parish or our church or our community, it's the Lord's parish and the Lord's church and the Lord's community. It's about us becoming more and more the church that the Lord wants us to be, which may or may not correspond with our preferred vision of what the church should be. It may, but it may not. And that's where the discernment comes in. That's where the role of the bishops comes in. Not because, you know, they're particularly gifted or talented or anything, but because they've actually been ordained in order to fulfill this particular role of discernment in the church. And to do it, they have to hear and listen to the variety of voices, carefully and prayerfully discern what they're hearing, and allow themselves to be guided in communion with each other and the universal church in the decisions that they take. I'll just make this point, and then I think we might break and have a bit of time for morning tea and a chat amongst ourselves, and then we'll come back. So the last point I want to make before the break is this one. How are the bishops going to hear these voices? When the bishops finally get together somewhere in Australia, depending on what Archbishop Coleridge comes up with, for this final meeting, which might last for a day or might last for 2 days or might last for a week, we just don't know yet, and they have to make these final decisions, how are they going to do that? How are you, we, going to have confidence that when those bishops get together, they're getting together having really listened and discerned? So there has to be a process of intensive and extensive consultation. So it's got to be deep consultation and it's got to be wide consultation. Not enough that it be wide, it's also got to be deep. It's not enough that it be deep, it's also got to be wide. We need to hear everyone's voices. Not just those who speak the loudest or have the best education or any of those sorts of things. They're very important people too. Everybody's voice is important. And one of the challenges for us is to work out how we're going to make it as easy as possible for everybody to be a part of this. And I hope as I'm saying these things, you're thinking about your own little, or perhaps not so little, group of people. How is Marina, for example, at Identity WA going to ensure that the voices of the people with whom she works and for whom she works, how are we going to ensure that those voices are heard? How is Celia going to make sure that the voices of the staff and students at Notre Dame are heard in this consultation? How is Carol going to do that in Jeddah? How are you going to do it in Mercy Care? These are the kinds of questions that we ask, because it's all very well to say, you know, everyone's voice has got to be heard, but we've got to get a bit concrete about it. How are we going to make sure, how's Vicky going to make sure that the voices of our Indigenous people are heard? And I need a lot of help, because I can't listen to everybody all on my own, and I can't engage with everybody all on my own. It's going to need deep, prayerful listening to the Holy Spirit, who may be at work in ways we don't yet quite understand, who may have a few surprises in store for us. So there's going to need to be a certain openness, which, it's easy to say, but it's a bit of a challenge. You've actually got to let go of some of your prejudices and some of your presuppositions and some of your cherished ways of thinking about things, just in case the Holy Spirit might be knocking on the door trying to say, I want you to come in a slightly different direction. And that's as true for the bishops as it is for everybody else. So we have to have a humble openness to the wisdom of others, including, and I've added here deliberately, and especially, those who are not generally heard. Because I think we know from our own experience that when we engage in these kinds of things, there's a group of people who are already interested and who are articulate and who know how to handle technology and all the rest of it, and they're the ones who get engaged. And there's so many other people whose voices absolutely have to be heard, who don't quite know how to go about getting their voice heard or don't even believe that their voice is worth hearing. So these are some of the challenges that we're facing. And so we have to have a willingness, all of us, to be challenged and unsettled and stretched. Okay. Well, if that hasn't scared the pants off you, I don't know what will. Let's stop now. Let's have, I think, morning tea would be...
ready? Let's hope so.
I think we said 10:30, did we? Or?
They've been putting food out. It's all
okay, good. So we'll have a break. I won't set any time. We'll just see how the conversation's going. Maybe the conversation over morning tea is as important is what I've just been saying. And then when we come back, I do have a couple of other things. I really want to stress how this is related to the Year of Grace, because I think that's part of its history. And if we don't understand that, we'll miss something about the Plenary Council. So let's have a break. We'll come back perhaps in 20 minutes or so. And that'll give us another 45 minutes before we finish. Thanks, everybody. If possible. So just a couple of brief things, just a little bit of history with no detail at all, but just might be interesting for people to know that the last Plenary Council in Australia was in 1937. So they don't happen every day of the week. And the last one included New Zealand. This one won't be including New Zealand, given that we're at war with them at the moment. Ours will be just Australia this time around. And there were three previous plenary councils, 1885, 1895, and 1905. If you wanted to, you could have a look in historical records and see what those councils dealt with. The point I wanted to make is that these aren't things that happen on a regular basis. They're things that are quite extraordinary when the church is facing a special moment in its life. I did want to, as I said just before the break, just try and put the plenary council in the context of the year of grace, which you might remember was in 2011. Bishop Don might be able to help me here, but I think it was at least a year before that, maybe even 2 years before that, that the bishops at their plenary meetings, which we have in Sydney twice a year in May and November, had started to discuss what we could do at this particular moment in our church's life. So I'm talking about 8, 9, 10 years ago, because we recognised then, this was before the Royal Commission was called, certainly not before the horrors of the sexual abuse crisis were we've been made aware of, but nevertheless, before the Royal Commission was called. But there was just a recognition that somehow or other the church wasn't succeeding in engaging with many of its people, maybe even most of its people, that it just didn't seem that we were being the effective evangelizing church that we needed to be. And the bishops spent a lot of time over a number of these conferences discussing this, thinking about it, praying about it, reflecting on it. And we came to the conclusion that as a national church, in fact, in the Catholic tradition, there's no such thing as a national church, but all of the particular Church of Australia together, that's a more accurate way of putting it, we decided that we needed to do something together. Those of you who, we all experience it in practical terms, but in theory, some of you would know that each diocese is to a very, very significant measure absolutely independent. And so I have, for example, not the slightest jot of influence or authority outside of Western Australia. I can't tell anybody in any other part of the church what they should or shouldn't be doing, or if I tried to, they might tell me what I could do with my suggestions. I have, as the Metropolitan Archbishop, I have very, very tightly controlled areas of responsibility in relationship to the three dioceses of Broome, Geraldton and Bunbury. But to all practical intents and purposes, I, as the Bishop of Perth, have no authority outside of Perth. So we're a quite decentralised church, contrary to the popular view. We don't have a head of the Catholic Church in Australia. A lot of people seem to think that whoever's the Archbishop of Sydney must be the head of the Catholic Church in Australia. That's certainly not the case, because we don't have an Australian church. We have a church in Perth and a church in Sydney and a church in Melbourne, etc. Nevertheless, the bishops together decided that we needed to do something together, and the original suggestion was that we have a plenary council. Most of us didn't have a clue what a plenary council was, and I think it would be fair to say, certainly it was my reaction when I looked at that proposal, it just seemed a bit too legalistic to me, and that might have been the feeling some of you got when I was going through all of the canons earlier on. But in any event, I think the general consensus was that whatever we did 9, 10 years ago wasn't the time for a plenary council. We needed to do something else first, and we didn't know what. And so we continued to think and discuss and pray, and we eventually came to the decision to have the Year of Grace. And the reason why we decided on the Year of Grace, and it's related to the decision about the plenary council, was that many of us were convinced, and I was certainly one of them, that we as a church in Australia just weren't yet ready to properly and successfully and in depth tackle the many issues we faced until we had done, basically until we'd gone on retreat. We needed to go on retreat as a church in order to refocus ourselves on the things that really mattered. It was only once we had done that, that we might find ourselves in a position to be standing on solid ground in dealing with these many issues that face the church today. And so in a sense, the Year of Grace was, in its conception, meant to be a year of retreat for the Catholic Church in Australia. And at the heart of that year of retreat would be to get our gaze off ourselves, off our problems, off our failures, off our successes, off our challenges, and onto Christ. And you might remember that the heart of the Year of Grace was to contemplate the face of Christ. That just happens to be there. I didn't bring it in specially. That was one of the things we used during the Year of Grace. Let's focus again on Christ. Let's get back to him. And you know me well now. You know that that has been my understanding of my role as the Archbishop, beyond anything else, is to help us as a people to turn our gaze back to Christ, to give him back his church. And I think that that's still important. I think that's a work in progress. I think we made some good beginnings, but I think we've got a long way to go. But that was the impulse of the Year of Grace. It was a way of preparing for whatever might come next. And what's come next is the Plenary Council. The Year of Grace was very much based on Pope John Paul II's document, Novo Millennio in Aeunte, that he wrote to launch the church into the third millennium. The inspiration for the Plenary Council is also largely based on this document. And it would certainly repay all of us to go back and read that document again. Some of you have heard me say before, it's just a personal opinion, but I think history will show that this particular document of John Paul II's, out of everything that he wrote, and he wrote an awful lot of things, this will emerge as one of the most significant things he ever wrote. And it talks about how a church might renew itself in the third millennium. The thing that struck me and still strikes me, you've heard me, many of you repeat it often, is the quote, the three of them there, but the first one in particular. At one stage in the document, John Paul II is talking about all of the challenges the church faces and the mission that the church has to be an evangelizing community. And then he says, and I know it off by heart now, our witness would be hopelessly inadequate if we had not first contemplated his face. And I think that's a message we need to hear over and over again. We are nothing if we are not people whose gaze is centered on Christ. If we don't know him, we don't know what we're supposed to be offering anybody else. And I think that feeds into what I said earlier about some of the challenges that we'll face in the Plenary Council. The Plenary Council will be successful if those of us who have leadership in the church know what it is that we're trying to achieve. And what it is that we're trying to achieve is to form the disciples of Christ into a true community of disciples who are following the Good Shepherd. That's what the church is, and that's what all our efforts need to be directed towards. So we have to begin afresh from Christ. That's also from Novo Millennio in Aeunte. And of course, return the church to Christ and return Christ to the church has almost become my unofficial motto in this diocese, I think. And I'm very happy to have it that way. I thought it might be worth sharing with you something that Archbishop Coleridge wrote, which was part of the submission that we sent to Rome, asking for the Pope's approval of the Plenary Council. It's only a short extract, but I think it's important. He's talking, Archbishop Coleridge, of course, talking about the church here in Australia. The circumstances of the church in our time, not yesterday's church, today's church, including the patterns of change that are evident within the community of the church, and we could spend ages identifying these patterns of change. The church that I live in 2017 is very different to the one I lived in when I was a little boy growing up in Melbourne. Things are changing, and we need to acknowledge that and think through the implications of it. The issues confronting the church in modern multicultural and secular Australia, the increase in entrusting responsibility for and leadership of the Church's mission to laity, and even the changing face of the episcopate. I think what the Archbishop College is referring to there is two things. One is the significant increase in the number of religious who are now bishops. It's about a third of the conference are now bishops who belong to religious orders, and the slowly increasing multicultural face of the episcopate, with a Vietnamese bishop, a Chinese bishop, etc. So there's a changing face of the episcopate, which means the episcopate is gradually catching up with the rest of the country, which is a good thing. All of these things prompt the church to review, analyse and discern the signs of the times, to listen anew to the Spirit and to chart its course into the future. And there's that word discern again. Discern the signs of the times. It comes from the document from Vatican II, Gaudium et Spes, which talks about the signs of the times, but the full quote is to discern the signs of the times in the light of the gospel. Not just to say, oh, there's this particular movement in society which is very strong, and there's that particular movement in society which is very strong, we've got to go along with it because that's the signs of the times. It's about discerning, judging, evaluating, understanding these particular realities that are part of our life now in the light of the gospel. It's a little bit like that thing some of you have heard me talk about before, about culture. Any culture, whether it's a national culture or an ethnic culture or a religious culture or the culture of a diocese or the culture of an agency or whatever it might be, for us in our Catholic tradition, needs to be measured against the culture of the gospel. Are we deeply permeated by the culture of the gospel, or are we busily manipulating the culture of the gospel to fit in with our culture? I suppose we go the way around. So these are big issues, and I think Archbishop Coleridge has hit the nail on the head there. This brings me to, I think, a really important issue for us and a key challenge for us, and one of the reasons really why I wanted to call this group of people together. So this is, I'll put it up, it's kind of a thing in dot points, it's actually one sentence. I remember once when I was a young fellow studying for the priesthood, I got an essay back from my lecturer, and he made the comment that never in his life in correcting essays had he seen a sentence as long as this one, which actually was grammatically correct. So there we go. This might be even longer. This is the particular challenge for us. How to commit ourselves with energy to the long and intense process of engagement with the Plenary Council, while at the same time remaining committed to and actively pursuing the implementation of our archdiocesan plan, and at the same time embracing the opportunities presented to us by the announcement of the Australian Catholic Year for Youth in 2018, while also preparing for the Synod of Bishops on Young People, Faith and Vocational Discernment, scheduled for 2018, all the while continuing the day-to-day life and work of the Church. Long sentence. Teachers in the room can tell me whether it's grammatically correct or not. I think it probably is, no? Maybe people shaking their heads at me. But whether it's grammatically correct, I think the challenge is correct. Because I don't want any of these things, we shouldn't want any of these things to be lost. But how we're going to do it, how the diocese is going to hold all of this together and really make the most of the opportunity that this actually presents to us, I think that's a really important question. I think, for example, and I don't know because, as I said earlier, it is an Abrahamic journey and who knows where it will take us, but I suspect that at least some of the issues that might be identified through the process of consultation for the council will be exactly the issues that were identified in the process for the consultation for the archdiocesan plan. There's bound to be some coherence between those things. So we've got to try and think through a strategy, and I don't think we can come up with that strategy this morning. This is only the beginning of the conversation. But I think we need to think through a strategy about how each of you in your own individual settings, but all of us together, for the good of the Archdiocese, are going to do this. Some of you may be aware, I should have said this right at the start, and I do apologise, but Deborah Sace, who is sitting here with us, is a member of the, what's it been called, Deb, now?
Executive Plenary
Commission for the Plenary Council, which is that group of people from across the country who will work with the Australian, with the Bishops' Commission for the Plenary Council in the implementation, the devising of the consultation processes, all of that sort of stuff. So Deborah is going to be a key person for us. And Deborah has a full-time job, or probably two or three full-time jobs, so I'm not expecting Deborah to do everything. But you know, we'll need to come up with some suggestions as to what sort of structures we're going to have to put in place. You need structures for these things to happen. What sort of structures are we going to put in place to try and realise on the ground the kinds of things I'm talking about this morning? So that's important. By the way, if anyone wants a copy of these PowerPoint slides, they could just contact, send your email address to Jennifer and we can forward them to you, because this, it's all here. But I think that needs a lot of thinking through. The next slide, just ignore. And I wanted to then go on just to say a few brief words about the particular and urgent challenge of the Royal Commission. As I said to you, if you followed the final hearings of the Royal Commission those last 3 weeks, which were dedicated to investigating this issue from the point of view of the Church, the Catholic Church, and the last 3 days, which were the Metropolitan Archbishops giving evidence, you might have noticed that the bishops, particularly Archbishop Coleridge, of course, but also the Royal Commission and Gail Furness, the council assisting, constantly were referring to the Plenary Council. Now, we didn't come up with the idea of a Plenary Council in order to convince the Royal Commission that we were going to do something positive. We'd already made this decision long before. But the Royal Commission, I think, has latched on to that and is expecting a great deal from the Plenary Council. And I think some of the bishops and many other people are also operating with the same expectation. So we won't be able to put aside, nor should we, the issue of the Royal Commission and the crisis of sexual abuse in our work towards the Plenary Council and in our discussions around the Plenary Council. So I think it's important to see that this will inevitably be a major factor, and it needs to be a major factor, but it's not the only issue that we're facing, and somehow or other we're also going to have to keep all of that in play. So this is my attempt when I was putting this thing together, just to sum up in a few words, which is impossible to do really, some of the key issues that I think we have to think through. If the Church is called to be the healer of wounds and the warmer of hearts, which is a great quote from Pope Francis, how are we, when I say we, I mean we as the Church in this archdiocese, in the face of the enormous suffering inflicted on so many by some clergy, religious and other church personnel, in the face of the failures of leadership now so evident in responding to this tragedy, in the face of the ongoing need for vigilance to ensure it never happens again, how are we going to deal with the confronting question as to what factors in the Church's culture and practice facilitated this dreadful and shameful reality in our Church, and the painful exposure of our failures at the Royal Commission? What factors in our Church's culture and practice have facilitated this, have allowed it to happen, and which may still be operating in the life of the Church today? How are we going to deal with these things? And how are we going to respond as the community of faith, which is meant to be a privileged place of encounter with the Lord? The Royal Commission identified, in a sense we can say this, identified 4 things which it saw as pivotal to the cultural issues relating to the Royal Commission. Neville Owen, whom most of us here would know, of course, who has been the chair of the Truth, Justice and Healing Council, still is. Francis Sullivan is the CEO, but Neville Owen is the chair, often speaks about what he calls the four C's that have come out of the Royal Commission for cultural issues. One is the confessional, which, as you know, is the big topic at the moment. One is clericalism. One is celibacy. And the fourth is canon law. And when they talk about canon law, the Royal Commission, I think, is really talking about what it sees as a culture of secrecy, and also a culture of that sense that the church stands outside the normal structures of our society, etc., that somehow or other it's exempt from the normal processes of scrutiny and accountability and all of those sorts of things. Now, whether Neville is right, whether the Royal Commission is right, I think is something that needs a lot more discussion and reflection and discernment, to use that word again. But it does point to the conviction that I think operates in the commissioners of the Royal Commission that there are particular cultural factors which have been very significant in the prevalence of sexual abuse in our society. I'm not proposing we talk about this now, I just wanted to raise it because I think it could well be precisely this question of the culture of the church in Australia, as opposed to the doctrine of the church or the tradition of the church, the culture of the church, which may need to be looked at in one way or another by the Royal Commission. So I wanted just to raise it. It will be impossible, and it would be quite immoral of us, to ignore this dreadful reality as we look towards the Plenary Council. It will be very much present in our own minds. It will certainly be present in the minds of the wider society as they look at what's going on. And I think it presents some particular and perhaps confronting and unsettling questions for us, but they need to be acknowledged and they need to be faced. Okay, I wonder, it's 11:15, I want to finish at 11:30. We've got a little prayer at the end to finish with, but I'm just wondering now whether anybody wants to make any comments or ask questions or make suggestions as to how we might move on from here. Do we need we've got a microphone here, so maybe, otherwise we might not be Peter, so.
Thank you. Just in relation to that last slide, I guess the challenge is going to be, in the public's mind, a timing issue. So the Royal Commission has now come out with its recommendations. This Plenary Council doesn't happen until 2020, mm-hmm. and presumably whatever comes out of it will take time to implement,
mm-hmm.
unless we can demonstrate as a church that we're doing something between now and then,
mm.
and you already have with safeguarding officers and all the things that we've done. But I think we can't just say this is an important issue and we'll think about it at the
yes.
Plenary Council.
Yes.
That's just not going to wash.
Yeah. Look, I think you're absolutely right, and I it would be important for me to make the point that the decision about the Plenary Council wasn't a response to the Royal Commission. We are, in a sense, we're waiting. It's true that the Royal Commission has now issued some of its recommendations. They're related to legal matters, including whether or not the legal protections around the Sacrament of Reconciliation will continue or be abolished. So they've only issued some recommendations. There'll be many more. The final report, as I understand it, is due in the middle of December. It will be given by the Royal Commission to the Governor-General. The Governor-General gives it to the government. The government then decides when to table it in Parliament. And once it's tabled in Parliament, that's when it's kind of the final report. Now, whether that happens before Christmas or whether the government decides to hold it over till after Christmas, it's completely out of our hands. We don't know. There is already discussion, as well as being on the Bishop's Commission for the Plenary Council, I'm also on what's called the Supervisory Group, which is the group that oversees the work of the Truth, Justice and Healing Council. And there is already discussion going on between the bishops on the Supervisory Group and the religious, because it's a joint bishops and religious body, between them and the TJHC about the kinds of things we'll need to have in place to respond as quickly and efficiently as we can and properly to the recommendation. So we're certainly not going to wait for the Plenary Council. We're very conscious of that. But I think the cultural questions, and the Royal Commission I'm sure will refer to them, but the cultural questions are deep-seated things. I don't know if you've ever been involved in a process of trying to change a culture. You can change structures all you like, but cultures are another thing. There was a great quote that was, I can't remember who said it, but it's been quoted a number of times. When someone was talking at the Royal Commission in those last 3 weeks about the things that might need to change, and they said, you know, obviously structures are going to have to change and all the rest of it, which is true. And someone said, well, that's all very well, but culture eats structures for breakfast. You can change all the structures you like, and we'll need to look at those, but changing the culture will be a much longer term thing. And so I think there's going to need to be an immediate response to what the government said. Our problem, not our problem, our challenge what we will need to deal with is whether or not the government accepts all the recommendations of the Royal Commission. So even though there's a lot of interest at the moment about the confession question, whether the government decides to accept that recommendation or not, we just have to wait and see. Then if they do accept that recommendation, then the church will have to decide how it's going to respond, remembering, of course, that that particular issue deals with the universal law of the church. The bishops have absolutely no capacity to change the universal law of the church for us to change it in Australia. So the final report of the Royal Commission at the end of this year and into the beginning of next year, its tabling in Parliament, the response of the government, and then the response of ourselves as the Catholic Church and many other institutions, that's all going to play itself out, I think, over the next, after December, the next 6 to 12 months and longer. And into that's why I'm saying that the Royal Commission will have a major impact on the Plenary Council. But I think you're absolutely right that we can't keep saying, and we haven't been, look, we'll deal with that when we get to the Plenary Council, because that would be both a completely inadequate response to the horrors that we're facing, and also would be a very unconvincing kind of response. So.
Jim, that maybe it's circles that I move in, but there doesn't seem to be necessarily a concern about the structures. It's more about people being listened to now, and what's happened to the people who have been faithful people who've come to church, and there doesn't seem to be in this archdiocese any opportunity for them to, I suppose, what, you know, in brutal terms, is vent their feelings about what's happened. And is it the intention that you're going to wait till the Royal Commission stuff has been tabled? I don't think that's what people are looking for. I think people are really looking to be listened to now. And I notice in this archdiocese that we haven't really had any opportunity for people who are really hurting. We're talking about being the face of Jesus and healing wounds, and there's a lot of people out there hurting about the faith that they put into their particular priest or the faith that they put into their church, and nobody is listening to them. I mean, we have lots of people coming to Emmanuel Centre, and it's got nothing to do with disability. It's just that they're tormented by the fact that this happened and nobody really wants to listen to them. There's been a couple of priests in this diocese that have had a little meeting, but there's nothing official.
I accept that, Barbara, and I think the challenge for us always, and there are different views about this, but the challenge for us always is to be able to work out what will help rather than hurt. For example, immediately after the final hearings, we looked at a proposal initially for our priests, because they too are persons, at dealing with this. And one of the people we contacted about it was Kathleen, anyway, the woman, she's from the Wollongong Diocese, who's on the Papal Commission. And her very clear advice to us was it was too soon. So some people are looking for something immediately, other people are saying to us, it's not the right time. And so we're caught between, we have the desire to do the right thing, but we're getting conflicting advice as to what's the right thing. But I understand what you're saying and I accept it. So there are many voices, that's all I'm saying.
And, and somehow we as a church need to meet the needs of both people.
Yes, exactly. And in the end, as I say, I think the difficult question is, how do we do it in such a way that, as best we can, we ensure that it heals rather than hurts? That's the key question. But I honestly, I do understand what you're saying. We're trying, and we've looked at a number of proposals. We perhaps need to move a bit more quickly. Thanks.
Just in regard to the Plenary Council, I think when you talk about cultural change, I suppose having been in a religious order that's just gone through 5 years of trying to create some cultural change from being individual, isolated, you know, bodies into one national body, and then getting ready for a chapter. I think the Plenary Council, to me, just has little echoes of some of that preparation that we probably went through as religious sisters, but also the notion of discernment. So I think the whole concept of the Plenary Council, and maybe the process, depending on how we engage with a process for it, I think has huge potential for making some positive change, because it tends to lead itself to listening to a lot of people, and not just about, you know, ticking the boxes or something. I suppose that's the challenge. So I'm quite excited if we can make this work, given what we've been through, the church in Australia, if not the church universal that we're talking about, and the church here. So I'm kind of excited about the possibilities, because to me, structural change is very boring, but this is very exciting.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, I mean, I'm glad that you're excited. I hope that we all can see the potential for this. I think we do need to do a bit of the boring structural change in order to have the ways in which the more life-giving stuff can actually be implemented and start to happen. I think the key decision, and Deborah will be in a position probably after the next few meetings with the Executive Commission to talk to us about what the process or processes might be to engage people. The engagement of people is the key to the whole thing. Yeah.
I just sort of affirm probably what Barbara said, and that's something that I'm was hearing with the Aboriginal community, but also just it's a constant thing just in the wider Catholic community is we think it's great that we're doing so much on safeguarding and that our churches are, but those people who have that commitment to church, having a place that's safe to talk about those feelings, because it's not safe in the public sphere to be having conversations about this, or even just at dinner with your friends, you're attacked as opposed to actually let's have a safe place. But I was just wondering what for this archdiocese, what the next steps are. So are we waiting on the advice of the commission that Deborah's on, and will that kind of guide how we then engage in that process?
I certainly think we need to wait for a little bit more clarity around the process, because the process, I mean, we can do our own thing here in Perth in one sense, but the process is for the whole church to engage. And if the consultation is to be effective, it probably needs certainly to be very carefully designed, but then applied right across the country so people are all responding to the same kinds of things. So my intention in gathering all of you this morning was simply to begin the process of thinking about this and beginning to think about how we might move forward next. We don't have time to make those decisions this morning, and it's obviously up to me now to think, well, how do I draw from whatever comes out of your own individual and sort of joint discussing and praying and reflecting about this. How do I draw on that to make some decisions about what the process will look like here, but I do think we need to also hear from the this commission that the bishops have set up.
Thanks, Archbishop. I'm sure you've already all thought of it, but given that we do have the Year of Youth next year, I would have thought that using that as many things within the Year of Youth to hear the youth voice, the plaintiff wails, or text they might send, but utilising the Year of Youth, even to road test some of the ways of actually communicating with youth is different from old people, but linking those in, and so having it coordinated, so Deb also working closely with Anita and others.
Anita might like to make a comment about that, because there has been a consultation already across the whole country of young people in preparation for the synod on bishops on young people. So Anita might want to just say a word about that. It's partly what Siri was suggesting, I think.
Yeah, so the synod survey that the Archbishop just referred to, so the ACBC sent out an online survey for young people to complete around the questions that the Holy Father had asked. Nationally, we had about 10,000 responses, I think. I've got a report here with me. We received the email on Monday with 1,200 responses from the Archdiocese of Perth, which is around a whole range of different things in terms of church. But I think, I mean, the questions came from the Vatican, and so I have mixed feelings because of the questions. Don't record that bit. But I think it gave us a process at least to try in that sense, but and it's interesting to see the voice, and we targeted there's young people with Indigenous background, with disabilities, with non-Catholic young people as well having a voice and all of that. So yeah, I'm pretty sure I can send the survey results.
Let me find. I haven't had a chance to have a look at it yet, okay. So let me have a look at it. Not that I want to keep anything secret, it's not actually our survey, so.
Yeah. But it's a really great start, I think, at least. And the Year of Youth, that was for the Synod. So the Year of Youth then is actually going to be targeting our local church, thinking about our engagement of our young people. And that our young people are those up to the age of 30. And you know, I was talking to Greg Russo about when I became a director for the Archdiocese. I was actually still in my 20s. And
we want to ask you how old you are.
21. but the value of our young professionals, of our young people in their 20s, is actually quite a valuable resource in our church. And I think the Year of Youth is actually really focusing not just on our teenagers and school age kids, but also that young professional and that engagement in our local church.
Thanks, Anita. We might have to bring it to a close there because it's almost half past, and I do want to just finish with a prayer. What I'm hoping will come out of this morning, first of all, is that the key leaders, or many of the key leaders in our Archdiocese, now perhaps have a better understanding of this reality that we have ahead of us, the opportunities that it provides for us, some of the challenges around. And I'm sure you're thinking of them even more perhaps concretely than I am, because you're engaged in these very on-the-ground concrete agencies. The challenges around how we're going to actually make the most of this for our Archdiocese and for all of the different groups in the Archdiocese. I'm just not quite sure how we can gather the wisdom that might come out of the ongoing discussions, but it may be as simple as contacting, not Deborah because she's got other things to do, but just contacting my office, perhaps sending in an email or a letter or something with any suggestions that you might have about, look, why don't you think about this, or would this be a possibility, or why don't we have another one of these things, or whatever. I think we need to keep the momentum going. We do need to wait for the Bishop's Commission on the Plenary Council and for the commission that Deborah's on to begin to provide us with some more guidance and some more information. 2020, you know, once St. Peter was suggesting it's a fair way away, and yet we're already well into the second half of 2017. And if we're going to have the meetings in 2020, we've only got 2018 and 2019 to do all of this work of reflecting, consulting, praying, collating, judging, and bringing it all to some sort of conclusion. So we don't have a lot of time. We're not panicking, but you know, I think this is the right time to start the conversation. So I'll just lead us through this final prayer. This is the unofficial prayer for the Plenary Council. So it could change. I didn't write it, but it's there, and I think we can pray it together and wait for any later prayer that will come out. So. We say it together. Come, Holy Spirit, wind and fire of heaven, blowing and burning through the land down under to make the desert bloom. Open our hearts to see your footprints and our ears to hear your song. Give us wisdom to discern your ways and courage to do what we discern. Drive from us all discord and division. May your love sustain us towards and beyond the Plenary Council, all for your great glory. As we honour the past and stand in the present, may we embrace your future. May our thoughts, words and decisions be for the good of the Church in this land and for your peace and healing upon us all. Come, Spirit of Truth, breath of the Plenary Council, living and reigning with the Father and the Son, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Mary, Hope of Christians.
Pray for us.
Saint Mary of the Cross, MacKillop.
Pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let me just finish by thanking all those people who put so much time and effort into preparing for this morning's session. Thank you particularly to all of you for taking the time to come. Thank you to Jennifer for coordinating the whole thing and getting everything organised, and for to the staff from the Archdiocesan Administration Centre for setting the place up, for making sure the IT was working, for getting the morning tea and all of that ready. So, as always, these things take a lot of time and commitment and generosity on the part of many people. So, on your behalf, I thank them all. And I look forward to all of us working together to make this exciting possibility for us a real reality in our church. So thanks very much, everybody. Thanks for coming.